countries are really trying to find avenues, ways of moving forward, rather than restating traditional positions. So there's a real willingness to shift the thinking, and that has been evident in a number of areas. On adaptation, countries have very interestingly been talking about success stories that they have in already dealing with impacts of climate change, but also identifying barriers in their response, and then, of course, talk about a possible insurance mechanism. Dealing with insurance is of fundamental importance in order to meet adaptation objectives, and there are a number of reasons for this. The first is that if you can't get insurance because climate change makes you too high risk, no one else is going to lend you money for any other economic activity either. The insurance industry cannot offer lower premiums to those who do take action to climate-proof themselves. There is no incentive to act appropriately. In terms of a potential insurance mechanism, there is a proposal from the Alliance of Small Island States for an insurance mechanism, a multi-windowed mechanism to address loss and damage from climate change impacts with insurance rehabilitation and compensatory and risk management components. So that is a very interesting topic that is emerging. Quite a lot of debate on conservation versus market incentives via credits to avoid deforestation. Recognition that both deforestation and forest degradation affect the livelihoods of indigenous peoples, and that this should be an important part of the debate. The suggestion has been raised for a special consultation on the issues of indigenous peoples and how those relate to emissions from deforestation and forest degradation sometime next year. And there has also been discussion on financial flows and investments in the context of this issue. In other words, how can you put incentives in place? Also good work under the Kyoto Protocol. An issue that was originally referred to as spillover effects is now being discussed much more in the context of potential consequences of policies to address climate change. I would characterize the meeting so far as a good push forward on the discussion towards Copenhagen. We now have to turn this good push into draft decisions and conclusions that can be adopted on Wednesday. And at the same time, this is the moment when we need to be getting ready for the arrival of ministers, because we very clearly need their political guidance for the remaining year between now and Copenhagen.